You just started doing math.
High years in life. I'm with my good friend Sheena Zimmerman, who I love and adore for a couple million lifetimes. She's a yoga and meditation teacher in Ojai, California. And I've asked her to come on to talk about, as I know so many people are reaching out to her in this time, advice she has, guidance, feedback she has on the map of what is happening to us. What it can mean to us and what we can do with that information, as well as just general mental hygiene. Hi, Gina.
Hi.
How's it going up there?
It's going okay.
How is your health? How is your family's health?
Well, we're good. Should I start giving more than one word answers?
I think one word is going to be great.
Yes, in that regard, I feel safe and blessed and comfortable in our little house. Mm-hmm. I'm in a little distinct space. It's my office, so that also makes me feel quite grateful that I even have this little space I can go to, and that my husband is at home with our little ones. He's home because his entire professional season got canceled, so There's been a dynamic of stress, but honestly, I think this sort of goes to the question that maybe you're going to ask me next, which is about the difference between a grip and a pause. But I think there's something that played out, and Frank's a soccer referee and works the professional season, which was just getting going, and then of course was canceled. And I remember the sort of days leading up to we got the news that it was going to be, so that's our major income stream as a family. And I think in the 2 days leading up to it, there's a lot of tension for both of us, especially me, just because I trend in that direction more, of holding and gripping. And then the information came, and then on some level it was better, right, than the fear place that preceded it, which I just think is an important thing to recognize in human consciousness, which is that the gripping and holding against the thing was causing much more upset than, you know, then we got the bad news, right? And then we just started to live into it.
Mm-hmm. So sort of examination of the reality of what the thing is rather than living in the anticipatory fear of what it may mean.
Yes, that really the cause of suffering on some level is when we hold ourselves tightly against something. And then even when this bad thing comes, or the thing comes that you are frightened of coming, then you can actually go into it.
Yeah.
Then we just began to live into, like, okay, you know, we got creative about now my income can increase in various ways. We pared down we obviously have certain blessings and privileges that there's not an immediate, like, oh, we don't know how to pay rent, but it's not, you know, it's not far off. So we're just sort of living in the pulse of entrusting ourselves to it. And then for me, you know, one thing that a meditative practice offers is, of course, access to this thing that we call the subtle field. And that one reason that we want access to that is, or in addition to the benefit of just obviously calming down, so there's less distortion in the field of thinking and awareness. One thing that happens if you can recede away from content and into this more contentless field is that you get into the contentless field, which is the field of potentiality. So it's also a really creative space. It makes you more dynamic and available to be like, what is the adaptation energy that I can sort of source to, you know, to up level? Because it may be, you know, a year that we don't have this income. Mm-hmm. And for that, we don't actually have adequate money. So, you know, we'll figure it out. But, you know, there's also going into the blessing that now that means he's home. And he's this beautiful homeschool dad now. And so I get to do what I also get to do, which is this work.
I love what you're saying about the field, and to sort of back up a bit, this idea of, as I mentioned, you live in Ojai, and we talked before about the fires that ravaged Ojai a year or two ago. I'm sorry?
The end of 2017.
I remember you said something so beautiful that you could feel that the earth had a pause. There was a stillness in the ash, that after the fire, there was a stillness. And in the stillness and in the ash, there's a real potential of what's to come. The cyclical nature of sort of suffering, the fire, the burn, the ash, and then the rebirth. And as everyone in America is sort of bracing collectively and maybe globally bracing for this peak, for this experience of which we're so terrified in the throes of already incredible suffering. So there's the peak that's coming, there's this pause, and then the after. And in the field that you're speaking of, right, you can examine the fear, and in the fear you can find the potential for energy, yes? And the energy can be clarity. Can you say more about that? Mm-hmm.
Try. I think that, you know, the idea of the pause that I don't remember saying, but that does sound rather true, about the thing that I think I remember saying then, or that I can connect with now, is that, you know, after the fire, everybody was talking about rebirth, which of course came. Right, but not immediately.
Right.
And we're much less comfortable with that in between time, which is really what we're in now too. Like, you know, if we consider the gifts that can hopefully be born of this period of collective death and suffering that we're in, we can orient ourselves to that. I think for sure it's true. I think ecologically already we're obviously seeing that. I think the possibility of the death of some structures that are deleterious is there, hopefully, but we don't know yet, right? So we're in this place where, like, hoping is not exactly a practice of any kind. That's sort of another way of taking ourselves out of where we are. And then, you know, negative ideation about the future is not that different than hoping, in the sense that one has a sort of positive encoding, one is a difficult one, but they're both out, right, of the current reality.
Awesome. Yes, totally.
So really what the pause is an in. You know, and it's like the space between breaths. Mm-hmm. It's that there is a really, you know, and that's why the breath is one of the reasons that the breath is such a powerful teacher. Not, again, not just to calm us down, although that's a really necessary first step, because otherwise the distortion is too high to really organize intelligence. Mm-hmm. But what happens is, I think a lot of people think spiritual practice or meditation or whatever, or breathing practices, are to calm down only, like to go away from stress. And again, I would say, yes, obviously that's a first step, but really they are to go into something, to be available to go into something. So we go into the pause that's there, which is like just there, it's built in. Mm-hmm. So we start to have a relationship to where things come from, the birthplace of a breath or a thought, or a day, or this period of time. And then we have a sense of where it goes to, right? So if we can allow the death place, the giving away, the dissolving of our constant desire to assert storytelling, if we can give that away enough to get to the sort of death place, right? Like just letting that thought dissolve and dissolve into its kind of, people, the scholars call it the pre-discursive field, just the like, place before it's an iteration, the impulse of it, the field of potentiality. Mm-hmm. If we can be with the allowing of letting something go to that, which is scary too, because we think that knowing how things are is going to assuage the concern. That's why we are information seeking, which of course doesn't actually work, because it's an endless loop. It will not ever work. Mm-hmm. It will not ever work because right now you're getting bad news. Okay. But also, even if the news weren't bad, quote unquote bad, it would never work, because it just continues the loop to need more, seeking more external information, right? Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. So we're willing to give up the sort of seeking or storytelling or codification or like lockdown uncertainty, really. Like we're like, I want to know how it is. It's control. And if we're willing to do that, then we are start to let things dissolve. Why? Not just to give them away, but to get closer to the place of birth. Now that, you know, because the end of the breath is the source place of the next breath, obviously, right? You just kind of rest into the curve of the birth. Now, I think that if we can get on board with that, which I think a lot of people can, then you get back to this conversation about the fire. Which is that we're like, okay, the fire happened. Ooh, let's go to the birth. and it's really like these pauses, these ellipses, the space between is often longer than we're comfortable with. And that's where we are now. How do we live in the space in between? Mm-hmm. So that's where I think you get to the questions of sort of what you called mental hygiene, or, you know, like I've been posing to students, and inwardly I've been posing it in the form of what sustains you. Because now we are in this long pause, right? Even if we're not talking about sort of the collective global suffering, which of course is a huge piece of this, just what do you do all fucking day, with, you know, the movement of a life is very different, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
So to me, in addition to meditation, which just is not important in and of itself, just because we want to have a sort of vanity project of being meditators, it's because it's usually necessary for me certainly, and I think for most of us, in order to habituate the minds to that capacity to just give up the agitation just enough to dwell into something that usually needs to be done in a pretty habitual way, mm-hmm. to lay the ground, right? Yeah. But we're not interested in the closed-eyed state, really, because that would be about renouncing the world. And we're all trying to get into the world, right? We are in the world. There's nowhere to go. So we close our eyes to open our eyes, which is one of my first teachers always said. And that goes both ways, obviously. Like, you close your eyes and something wakes up. And also we close our eyes to then, you know, refresh and renew with life. This is always the endeavor of life. It's always going to have the sustaining is actually always harder than the birth and the death. We're afraid of the death, but really the sustaining, like how to just, because like your life is doing this, obviously. It had a beginning and it will have an end. And now we're in the middle. So how do we refresh and renew and become alive into the long fucking slog of being alive? Right? How do we live in, and also with a very tender touch that obviously some of the time it's going to just be a slog. And we're not like optimizing all the time. We're just living. But I think for now, I can feel in myself, I was saying to you, Daniel, before we turned on the camera, that I can feel there's this like stasis in my body, partly just literally because I'm not moving enough. But also, I think that's what, you know, I have this like nerve conversation in my whole side. And I think that's a way that it's a stress holding that's happening, at, you know, sort of in an embodied way. So I think for all of us, it's like, it's going to be longer than we thought. It was like, we had the shock phase of, okay, give up life as usual. And then we had a beginning phase where there was, and then now we're in sort of somewhere in the middle of an indeterminate amount of time that we're going to be in this kind of home base mode of existence. Yeah.
Let's keep going.
Okay.
But this is going to be the, and now we're going to keep going. Please keep going.
Oh.
That's it. I mean, there's nothing else to do. I'm just saying that because the first half of this will probably be on Instagram TV, and then this full thing will be, I'm speaking to the medium that's going to hold the content, which is really a surreal
experience. I know. It's a strange piece. But now we just keep going.
That's, I mean, we're in the slog.
So I think that, you know, what sustains you is an important question all the time, and perhaps especially so now. So in addition to a meditative practice, so now, you know, now that we're even limited in how much we can go outside, obviously getting outside and taking walks as much as you can, but, you know, that's amongst the myriad privileges that I'm aware of is where I live.
Yes.
Right, I've spent much of my adult life in cities, and that just would be a different
yes
circumstance. So. Breath work, like if you know breath of fire or things that move energy pretty quickly, these are things that I think are important. If you have a way of doing inversions safely, like obviously you need either an inversion table or a yoga practice to go into shoulder stand or a headstand or something, that's a pretty effective way to move a lot of energy pretty quickly.
Would a wheel be good too?
Wheel is good, yeah. Yeah. Not because it's an inversion as much, but because of the heart opening and the major movement. Yeah. You know, if we tend to ourselves as energetic beings, it's also just like, I think everybody has to decide for themselves, but everybody should be prudent with their decision making around how much information to take in. I think that what happens is that, and in my opinion, you should not, ideally, if we can start to have the discipline to do this, not start the day with a ton of social media or other news and not end the day with it.
Agreed.
It's just like, you know, those are the beautiful transition points of the day, the sandhya times, the time when the day is dawning and the time when the day is receding. Because obviously nature is continuing in its cycles of constant renewal, birth and death. We're not. I mean, we're part of it. We put ourselves to bed and we're part of it. We're in the diurnal system, but we, because of storytelling, basically go on lockdown. And I think that one thing I've been noticing that's interesting to get is that anxiety, agitation at the surface of mind, which is in part based on, you know, like this excessive movement of the thought streams bouncing between within itself, feels like an excess of movement, which it is at a certain level. But really, it's based on stasis. It's really like if we can move energy more adeptly, then some of this agitation will take care of itself. Mm. So that comes in, you know, it's, you can even, if you want, like put a reminder on your phone every hour, hour and a half or two, you know, to do 15 minutes of some kind of movement. And that can mean any movement that you want. These are like nerdy little things.
Oh, no.
I think it's pretty, you know, I can definitely tell that I haven't been doing that enough, the physical part of this, in the last few days, and it's having consequences.
I'm laughing because I have this reminder on my phone that 6 or 7 times a day, it says, don't forget you're going to die, and why my son always teases me about it. I find it very engaging. It's a call to engagement. Well, what's actually going on in this moment?
Yeah.
It's a celebratory reminder. So you talked about the necessity for sort of orienting your mind, so practices of discipline around information intake and moving your body. Those are the two things that I'm getting. It's like strong, what I'd like to call mental hygiene tips during the pandemic. I want to ask you something about, go ahead.
Oh, breathwork, inversions.
So yeah, think ways to connect with the body through breathwork, through inversions, and then having discipline, if possible, to monitor the intake of information. I want to ask something of you that I've come to understand as anxiety, and I'm curious your take on it, because you talked about it as movement. I have understood anxiety as the experience of it requiring more effort from the conscious mind to suppress what is coming up in the unconscious mind. And that experience of that dynamic is the creation of anxiety. And I find this is a useful definition because in that, the power of anxiety, there's more potential power for me in the experience of anxiety. And I struggle with anxiety, right? Is that anxiety is not rendering me helpless. It is the opportunity for me to ask, well, what is this saying to me? What information is being revealed? Do you have any thoughts on that?
I love that definition. And it's more, I mean, it's a totally valuable one. I think it has more psychotherapeutic roots than I, you know, it's not my training as much. So I don't know if, you know, more just from my experience also of it and also from the teachings in the tantric tradition, mm-hmm. You know, the way that I experience it or instruct with it often has something to do. So anxiety is on some level a desire to get out. Love, right? Like we don't like something, we want to get the fuck out of there, which is a very, very understandable response.
Yes, of course.
It's not ever fruitful though. And as we know that, you know, vacating is really what causes trauma too. So we drop the story and become embodied into the breath and into the heart. We can do that right now if you want. Want to?
Yes.
Okay, so, you know, you could, if you wanted, close your eyes. You and all the yous that we might be talking to out there. And so this idea, drop the story. It just means, for now anyway, give away the way you're holding yourself so tightly to some particular storyline. And let your attention fall to the heart. So what is that? Sort of this general region of the center of the chest and back from there a little bit. The lungs are held there, so you come right to your breath. And then when we say come to the heart, we mean come to the field of open awareness, just the place that is aware of whatever, right? On some level, if we can orient to the awareness itself, we just go to the breath. And then if you can, let your attention go sort of back from the physical heart, like to the back of your ribs. And then let your awareness open. Now that sounds sort of esoteric and woo-hoo, but it just means, can you sense the space behind your physical body? Can you sense back maybe into even the back corners of the room that you're in? Can you relax out into the sides of the space that you're in, and forward and up? And you can open your eyes. You could, of course, keep them closed for longer than that, but you could also know that just that amount of time is quite adequate. To do this thing. So what's happening there is, of course, not just that we're calming down, which is pretty major. We're calming down by giving away the way we're holding ourselves so tightly against anything, right? It's back to that other conversation that the resistance to the thing is right. The cause of suffering. The other thing that happens there is that, sorry, I'm looking at this. So I was on a live call with Pema Chodron, which was like me and 6,000 people, but it was so thrilling to get to be to be live with her. I mean, obviously the treasure of that woman, but she said, holding on to yourself so tightly when what is really going to soothe you is opening our eyes to see what is shared with other people, right? So on a level even below thought, right? This has something to do with empathy and understanding the interconnectedness of this time, which is part of what makes it actually quite sublime.
Yes.
Simultaneously, you know, awful, right? We're not bypassing the awful by saying it's also sublime. We're saying it's awful and we're so connected. We already were. This is just really explicating how much we are. So that's the level where on some level we know that this is a feeling that doesn't feel good. There's real death, there's real despair, there's tragedy. But on the level that it's actually gorgeous is that it's reminding us of the interconnected nature that was already the truth of nature. And that essentially giving away the smallness of our identity not only soothes us. Why does it soothe you? Because it's giving into nature as it actually is, which is that you essentially are entangled. That's a word from physics, but that even if there's no obvious connection between you and that person, you are originally connected. But that's the essence of things. Mm. And that the cause of our suffering is when we sort of hold ourselves small. Mm. And the expanding of the field is an antidote to suffering, not just because we're trying to feel better personally, but because it's putting us back into that kind of vortex expansion of the truth of things, which is that we are in this thing together.
So many things that you're saying are bringing to mind so many things that I want to comment on. And I'm gonna refrain, but the one thing I wanna mention is that this idea of coming into awareness of our interconnectedness and in that sublimeness sort of facing the totality of suffering, right? So it's not liberation as much from suffering as sharing the space together of suffering. And yeah. Probably opening up the body to the real sadness of the experience and the potential beyond the sadness for the bliss of the experience. The curiosity to me, physiologically and neurophysiologically, is that when we're in self and we're in fear and the body is angry and scared, it's quite literally constrictive.
Yeah.
Which is physiologically detrimental to our mental health and physical health, and that opening up the view, the sadness, this grief, if you will, for what's happening, this rupture is a real openness, and it allows things to move. It is, as you say, it's the potential for us to face this together is kind of the only option, really, if you look at it.
Yeah, and to really be with each other in intimacy, in heart. Mm-hmm. And I think you use the word grief, and I think that that's an important teacher, because, you know, the teachings of fullness and of wellness and of connectedness cannot be dependent on having good feelings. Okay, I'm just going to speak to that a little bit more, but in our sort of contemporary spiritual marketplace, and I think just based on being in this country, you know, obviously people are listening from other countries, but in the U.S. especially, I think that, you know, it's a Protestant nation, so it's based on this, like, certain things are acceptable and certain things are not, and it's so ingrained in us that I think it takes a while to get this, that I think we think that we're doing well, and if we have what we call a spiritual practice, we think there's sort of evidence that we're, you know, on the path and that we're succeeding on the path. If we have certain types of feelings, which are like patient, generous, open, expanded, full, easy to understand that those feelings are full. Okay. Now what's really radical to get is that the feeling of fullness, and actually the word bliss even, that they're talking about in the tradition, and part of this is a translation issue, just because English doesn't, you know, I'm not a real reader of Pali or Sanskrit, but like, there's a gap there. But really what this bliss is not that fucking thing. It's not happiness at a sort of regular conventional level of happiness. That would be not really a spiritual practice. That would be saying, when things go my way, I am happy, and when they don't, I'm not, which is like very natural. Like, obviously we all want that, but we're being shown that it's not going to always go our way, right?
Yeah.
So instead of just like trying to get filled up again by some, you know, happy place, what is the fullness? How do we really orient to the fullness of being alive, the fullness of connectivity, the fullness of that expanded field in the difficult emotional places, in the difficult thought streams, in the seasons where things are not going our way, because that's just not how nature is. Even those of us who are privileged enough to have it go our way a lot more of the time than the rest of the fucking people, let's be honest.
Yeah. True.
So that's why grief is a really valuable teacher, because I think people can get this one. Because usually people are like, okay, even if we can get to that intellectually, it's very difficult. And for me, it's been difficult. It's taken years and years and continually kind of resetting to this, like, well, if we're not, aren't we trying to be happy? Isn't that kind of the point? Maybe. But really, what is that? Right? What is this kind of unconditional happiness? It's not happy like, yeah, it's not like a good mood feeling all the time. So we go to this teaching of grief. And I think on some level, we all have some sense that that is just a powerful indicator of this type of thing that we're talking about, which Pema also talked about in her way. But so grief is there, right? The loss of someone, the feeling, you know, even now there's a time of grief, like we've sort of had to say goodbye to seeing each other. There's a lot of death that we know there's despair, right? Grief is a real place that we can be in this. But we tell that's different than this other like anxiety agitation place somehow. And what's different about it, in fact, and so the grief is there and that doesn't feel good. And that's certainly not codified as like what we would call a happy feeling.
Mm-hmm.
But it expands, it connects. It's actually quite interconnected. We can really be with each other in it. We can see, we know that sometimes grief just sort of obliterates your boundaries so much that you just feel your closeness to everyone else.
Yes.
And so I think that grief is an important reset if we go like, oh yeah, that's an example that I actually know within myself is an example of an experiential state of this expanded field. It isn't a good feeling.
Right.
But it is arguably, you know, a good feeling in the sense that it's putting us back in line with nature. So I orient people's attention to that and myself to that as a teacher for what we're talking about when we're talking about being fully in life, right? It's not the kind of fullness where you're like, I feel super generous and I'm awesome and there's a parking spot and it's like, you know, what, who cares? Because it's not going to be like that all the time, right? And really that's all an animation of a smaller sense of who you are.
Mm-hmm.
You're telling yourself a good story about who you are and how things are going for you. And then if we can just give away the story and just go to the heart and the breath. Why the heart and the breath? Because that's just the thump and the pulse of life. You just are somewhere in the middle of it. Okay, also obviously because when we're stressed, we're holding our breath. We're all worried about a viral circumstance in the lungs on some level, and then we're holding our breath.
Mm.
So we really lovingly tend to the lungs just by breathing. And the heart is there, obviously. And then we open up who we think we are. And we do that again and again and again. And in some ways, our shared suffering is a really gorgeous way to do that.
Are you aware of the emotion connected to the lungs in Chinese medicine?
Grief.
Yeah. A little poetic, a little on the nose, Mother Nature, right?
It's a lot of on the nose. There's so much wisdom in the traditions, yeah.
Gina, we could talk for hours. I love you so much. I really appreciate you just sharing your wisdom and your empathy. Practices for people, I think it's really healing and useful to have you in the world sharing those things. I love you to bits.
I love you too. Thanks for asking me to come.
Sure, I hope we can do it again soon.
Love to everybody.